to be invited to join your course, and we'll spend around 1.5 hours in the afternoon. So the talk about the title for my talk is How Good Teaching Becomes Even Better. And I think we have a lot of good courses and a lot of very creative and good teachers at DTU, and we can always become even better. And I guess this is why we have this course, and we have a range of other courses that you can actually attend. And one of the ways to become better is to get feedback. We give feedback to kids all the time as they grow up. Hopefully they evolve in some good way. And the same we can do as teachers, get some feedback. And that's why I ask two of you to show up and sign up for being feedback persons today.
So.
I won't tell, not yet, but it's a good question. And actually, it points to me. So now you are attending a course on becoming even better at teaching. And here comes a teacher, and he asks something of you. Can two of you show up or sign up as feedback persons? Of course, you don't know what does it mean to be a feedback person. I could have told you, but on purpose I didn't. Because I wanted to demonstrate to you this reluctance. And this reluctance means that you are perhaps quite unsure what is all this about. And as you say, what does it mean to be a feedback person? I won't tell still, so it doesn't really hurt. It might be a good experience. I got one and I got another one. You see, I use feedback persons every time I teach, and I never start my lessons without having two volunteers. But of course, I need to explain to the students in the beginning of the course, what does it mean to be a feedback person? And once they have understood this, and once they know that I will never start, you know, before somebody has actually signed up, then it works perfectly. It also points something important for you, because now you are attending this course. Perhaps you get some good ideas. Hopefully you will. Then you'll come back to your departments and perhaps start teaching. And perhaps you will start to use some of the techniques that you have learned in this course. And perhaps your students have never seen a course like that. And you might see exactly the same reluctance, because perhaps the students are used to somebody doing a lecture all the time, or they are used to solving problems, you know, half an hour lecture, solve some problems. And if you come with something creative that you have developed yourself, then of course, perhaps it doesn't work the first time, because you didn't explain. This is different. So whenever I try something different or new with my students, I always start to explain, today we are going to do like this and that, because I believe this might be a great learning experience for you. And of course, if I have introduced the feedback persons, you have all signed up. Because what it means to be a feedback person is just attend this lesson, but also keep an eye on what works out in a great way and what can be improved. Afterwards, I'll just listen, write down, and then hopefully I will be able to improve some smaller issues, some bigger issues perhaps, and now this lesson will perhaps be even better next time. And in this way, hopefully I will be better and better as a teacher, and this lesson will be better and better. And of course, if you give the same course year after year, then perhaps the curriculum doesn't really change. And perhaps your teaching method doesn't really change, but the students are new every time, and they change over the years. So you always have to readjust your course. And based on feedback, then you can do it in a competent way, and also you can do it before the final evaluation of the course. So there are many great advantages. And what I will tell you about today is how I have incorporated feedback in some of the courses I teach here at DTU, One of them is called solid state electronics and microtechnology, another one micro and nano fabrication, and they are both 10 ECTS point courses that I have developed and taught since 1997. So I have met a lot of students. And first I'll tell you a little bit about the nature of the courses. Then actually back in 2001 I attended exactly this course, and I have made one slide summing up my experience from that time. Then I'll give you some examples, and we'll have a very short break, and then we'll speak about how to give and how to also receive feedback. And finally, we'll speak about how to plan feedback into whatever you are doing, it be a course or supervision. And by the way, how many of you are going to give a full 5 or 10 ECTS point course? A bunch of you, some of you, yeah. How many are going to give, say, 3 lectures in such a course? Some of you. How many are expecting to mostly supervise master students and bachelor students? Yeah, a lot of you. Okay, so we have a mixture here, just for me to know how I should take this into account. But one of the courses is called Solid State Electronics. It is a physics-based introduction to a range of devices. So we look at airbag sensors, we look at bipolar transistors, we look at diodes, and we cover basic theory. We cover how to fabricate these devices, and we also cover how to use these devices. And it's a mixture of there are some lecturing, there are problem solving, there are reverse engineering exercises where the students take things apart and figure out the inner workings. There are project work, there are experimental exercises. So it's a mixture of many different teaching styles, all selected in order to actually fulfill the learning objectives for the course. And back in 2001, I attended this course. And at that time, there was a great emphasis on grandmother's first law. And it states he or she who works learns. And the basic idea is if you as a student will be the active one, then you will pick up something by doing something. And if you're just, you know, sitting down and relaxing, just listening or viewing, then perhaps your learning experience will not be that great. And at that time I thought, well, can this be true? And I thought about some of my own courses that I have attended. I'm a physicist from a university. And there was a lot of the courses where I was actually not really that active. I had one course in physics. It was a great course. The teacher, he could even write a matrix, you know, by using two hands, so he could write A12 and A11 at the same time. And we all thought, wow, this is fantastic. He must be the best teacher ever. And you know, he could arrive and he could fill out 8 blackboards just in time. And after his lessons, everything was extremely clear. And we were clapping our hands. We were around, say, 300 people in the auditorium. Everyone was clapping and, you know, it was great entertainment. And I never really opened the book because everything was so clear to me. It went that way for, say, more than half a year. Then I tried to solve some of the old exam problems and realized that I didn't really, you know, I couldn't really figure out how to solve them. And then I thought perhaps I should be the active one instead of just listening. And it helped a lot. So then I had to be active, read in the book, try to solve problems and so on. And I figured out, well, it helps to be active. Then we also heard at that time the students, they should be engaged, they should love your course, and they should invest a lot of energy. And you know, most of the students will do, but of course you will also meet some students that really just have to pass the course. So you need to be able to deal with both these students, you know, being eager to learn something and those who just need to survive. And I've met a lot of teachers that were really active. And I also met some teachers, you know, they didn't really like the course and they didn't really have time to do the course. And of course, you can feel that as a student, perhaps you have even tried it yourself. having a course where you actually felt that this teacher should be doing perhaps something else. I've tried that. And of course, hopefully, when you get a course where you're going to be the actual one, it's within, you know, a subject that you really like, so you will put in a lot of energy. Hopefully, the students will do the same. And the last thing we heard was that the curriculum should be a reasonable challenge. And, you know, some courses might be too easy, some might be too difficult. And then, of course, teaching is more than just, you know, plain lecturing and, you know, slideshows. In the beginning, when I started, the teachers, they always used the blackboard. Then one day, I saw an overhead machine for the very first time. And we had one chemistry professor, and he could put on these overheads at a tremendous speed. And he always, you know, had a few hundreds for an hour or an hour and a half. He could cover, you know, chapter 8 in the book, his own research related to chapter 8 and everybody else's research related to chapter 8, and he could just put them on. Then I saw this was great, even, you know, with hand drawings and nice colors and so on. I thought, well, this is really great, until I actually discovered that I didn't have time to read what was on the axis of all the plots he was presenting. So it was kind of hard, you know, to figure out exactly what to do. Then one day I had to give lessons myself, and I of course started just by copying my old professors. I realized in the classroom there was no blackboards, so I had to use an overhead machine. So I prepared a lot of transparencies. I covered chapter 8 in the book, my own research, everybody else's research, and a lot of details, and I put it on. And I actually also took some pictures at that time. And these are the very bright students. And you know, I come in the classroom, I say, good morning, everyone. I turn my back, of course, to the students because I need to point up to all the important equations. So I put on transparencies at a tremendous speed. And then one day I turned around. And you know, I was kind of shocked because I thought they would all be active and engaged and really like the subject of solid state electronics. But apparently they didn't. You can see this guy here, though he seems awake. But I can tell you, he is actually not. It's fake. Because he has actually achieved the highest academic skill of them all. He is actually ready to be a PhD student. Because he has the very great skill of fake. He looks as if he is awake, but he's not. Because this is the way you need to train people in order to survive at a conference. You know, you have traveled for 2.5 days, you have jet lag, you are extremely tired, you sit in a very dark room, and you know, the very first 1 or 2 days before your own presentation, there's a lot of stuff that you really don't really know about. It's on a way too advanced level, at a tremendous pace, and you know, you're just sitting there, oh. And at that time, by the way, how many of you have never tried to drift away during a lesson and lose concentration? Come on, I guess some of you must have been active all the time. Who has never tried to lose concentration? As you can see, we have all tried to lose concentration. And of course, in this case, it's really a bad case. And at that time, I discovered grandmother's second law. He or she who sleeps learns nothing. And you know, it might not really be true because you have perhaps tried to wake up in the morning and suddenly you have a lot of good ideas. But apart from that, when you sleep during, you know, a lesson here at DTU, hopefully you won't. But if you do, I guess you really don't really learn a lot. And as you have seen, you have all actually tried to drift away. And that brings me to an exercise for you. So how long time can you actually speak before your audience will drift away? And we'll actually try to make a plot. So on one axis, we have time, t. And on the other axis, we have the, we could call it A. It's the awakeness of the students. And of course, it's ill-defined. But we could say, well, it's 1 when they are fully awake, and it's 0 in kind of this situation. And then, of course, we assume that we'll start at a value of 1. If you have tried to give a course at 8 o'clock in the morning, you might discover that the value of A will actually start very low, and then after a few cup of coffee, it might go towards 1 in the morning. But in the afternoon, it's often more close to 1. And of course, you start your lesson here, and you say blah, blah, blah. And at some point, you will reach this limit here. But we're looking for a critical value, say, around here. We'll call this value TC. And you will be team number 1. And you will be team number 2. And then, you know, just 2 and 2. Try and discuss and try to figure out what is the value of TC here. And I'll give you a few minutes for doing this. Okay? So please go ahead. Okay, before we continue with this exercise, did you notice what happened to the noise level in the classroom when I actually gave you an exercise? It went up. And the reason is now you're the active ones, because I've just been blah, 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 my background and courses and so on. Perhaps you even started to feel a little bit tired. But then suddenly came an exercise for you. And if you now look at this plot here, I can tell you what happened. So now again we have time t here. On this axis we have the, it could be the noise level, we could call it n. And you know, in the beginning, you know, before the break, you're just chatting a lot. The noise level is high. I start to speak, blah, blah, blah. Then suddenly, you know what happens? At this point in time, I give you an exercise. You start to discuss. Now you're the active one. And the noise level goes up and up and up. And you can easily hear that. Then at some point in time, in my experience, you will see a peak. And then it goes down again. And you can use these kind of exercises in your classroom to have a few hundred people discussing, or just 10 or 20. And then, of course, they should discuss something related to the topics that you are looking at. And you know, as a teacher, you can walk around, you can ask some extra questions to the very bright ones that might finish very fast. Or you can go around and try to help some of the students that have difficulties in actually answering and figuring out the questions. And of course, you need to figure out, when should I actually stop this exercise? But if you listen to the noise level, in my experience, there will be a peak, then it begins to actually drop down. And I was curious in the beginning, why does it really go down? And I've discovered why. Because, you know, first you start to discuss the technical matter. Once you have finished that, you start to discuss private matter. You know, in the Friday bar, what happened, and we had a few beers, and he was great looking, or she was great looking, and you know, blah, blah, blah. This is not for me, the teacher, to hear. So all the students, they lower their voice. But it's great that they are doing this, because then as a teacher, you know, at this point in time, I should better cut in, and then they can discuss private matter in the break, of course. And now you can say, okay, let's try to summarize, and then you can, you know, try to make a summary, or they could vote, or whatever. So these kind of class discussions, they are actually very helpful for you. You can build them into, say, plain lecturing. So ask a question that the students discuss. It's important to show the question on a slide. I learned that from some of my feedback persons, because in the beginning, when I tried out this technique, it was really really a pain, and because they were discussing all different kinds of related subjects. Never exactly the subject I wanted, but a lot of different subjects. And then one of the feedback person said to me, well, you know, Eric, he said, after 30 seconds, we forget what was the question? And then we try to reconstruct the question, and then we discuss that reconstruction. And it really helped me when I just put it on a slide, because, you know, then they know exactly what to discuss. And then you can walk around, you can summarize in the end. It works out very nicely. Of course, you should be careful to select something that can be solved within a few minutes, perhaps, related to your own field. But actually, having said that, I will allow you to continue your original discussions. So try to find the value of TC. Now I have demonstrated this technique. Okay, so please restart your discussions. Okay, perhaps we should try to make a summary, and we can start by asking team number one about your value. 15 to 20 minutes. And team number two? The same. Team number three? This would be quite boring. So the next team?
Depending on subject, but mostly the same.
Okay. Team number five?
About the same.
Exactly the same.
Yeah. And team number six? 15, yeah. Now something else. And team 7?
Depending on the subject.
Yes. Roughly?
20-25, depending on if you just speak all the time, mm-hmm. it would be less than 15 minutes.
Yeah.
But if you have some activity as well, you could take half an hour.
Mm. Okay. So roughly 20 or? Okay. And team number 8?
15 to 20.
And team number 9?
30 or 40.
Around 40. And team number 10? 15 to 20. Yeah. As you can see, they are roughly the same. And we have actually performed, you know, an investigation, a study, because all these values are based on your own experience. And I guess you have had quite a few courses during your lifetime. And as you can see, the DTU module for teaching is 4 hours. So looking at these numbers, 15 to 20 minutes, of course, we need to come up with something else than just having an old man lecturing all the afternoon. Friday afternoon, you can imagine, sitting there for 4 hours. It could be a pain. And of course, this is perhaps why you attend this kind of course, because you can get inspired, you can learn something, you can figure out great new ways to do teaching, so we can actually end up having a lot of different teaching styles, all selected to give a good learning experience where you can actually match the learning objectives. We'll get bright students and even better teachers, and in that way we'll just be better and better. And this is what it's all about. And I have a few examples where I have never seen people fall asleep. This is one example. So in one of the courses we are looking at how to fabricate devices using silicon as a material, and silicon can be bought as wafers. A wafer is just a disc of silicon, say this diameter, half a millimeter thick, and there you can make incredible things. You can make microcontrollers, you can make computer chips, but you can also make a lot of mechanical components like this one. So this is a membrane in a pressure sensor. This membrane is only 20 micrometers thick. If the pressure is high up here and lower down here, then it will bend downwards, just like a hat structure. And that we can measure electrically by having some embedded resistors here. And the students, they need to realize that you can create a two-dimensional structure. And that is all these layers here. They are almost two-dimensional. And you can do that by adding steps after step. So you could deposit some metal, say 200 nanometers. Then you can etch part of that metal away. Now you can add another material, etch part of that material away. And in this way, by just depositing layer by layer and removing part of the layer, you can build up a component. Just like when you are making a wedding cake, or in Danish, in lagkage, you also take, you know, one part of the cake, then you add some marmalade, then you take another layer of the cake, you add something else, and so on. Then you can continue, you add cream at the top, and so on. It's just the same. So we have implemented a process technique. So we start by some lecturing, 4 hours, a 4 hour lesson, where we have a few hours of discussions and lecturing, then they solve some problems. And then the next 4 hour block, we start by cleaning our hands, and then we start to make devices using a layered cake. We do that in the coffee room at Nanotech. And you can see these guys here, they are pretty active. They are actually depositing chocolate powder as a metal layer on top of the silicon disk. So they start to take a tour around Nanotech, look at all the posters to get ideas. And on all our posters, you can see many different kinds of devices. That could be pressure sensors, or that could be nanotubes arranged in some way. You might find a biosensor. You can find all different kinds of things. So they pick, you know, one device. Then they try to figure out, how could you make this device? And then they write down a process flow. You can see this is the process flow. And I go around, discuss with the students, and we look at the process flow. Then they figure out how to actually make all these different layers. And they also need to make patterns in these layers. And they could, for instance, take, you know, an overhead transparency. Then they can cut some holes, put the overhead transparency on top of the cake. Then they can apply chocolate powder. Now you can imagine, if you carefully lift away the transparency, then the pattern in the transparency will be filled on the cake with chocolate powder, and everywhere else you'll just have the cake lying around. And that also works great at home if you are going to make a cake with name on or whatever. And this is called a lift-off process in silicon technology. We do exactly the same. Instead of the overhead foil, we use another kind of polymer which we can pattern. Then we deposit metal everywhere. We dissolve the polymer, and it takes away the metal on top of the polymer, and we have a pattern on our silicon wafer. They can do exactly the same. But the nice thing here is that we can finish this exercise in a few hours. Doing so in the clean room, making a real device, could take a month or two. And you know, it's way out of the scope for a small course doing so. But using this exercise with the cake, we can easily create a lot of different devices. And I actually never call it a cake, I call it a device. Because this is not for fun, we're not just making a cake because they taste good. We are making it because we demonstrate how to make devices. So first they make the process flow, we discuss the process flow, and then in the end I come with a big knife, and then I take the device apart so we can compare the cross section of the device, that is the cake, with the cross-section that they have on paper. And then we discuss, you know, which steps were easy to perform, which steps were the difficult ones. And often it turns out that the same steps that are difficult in this cake type of approach will also be difficult in real life. So there's a lot of things that you can discuss. And they realize that careful planning is needed. And this is definitely true for any experiment. They also need to figure out to have all materials ready and so on. So there's a lot of things that they can actually learn. And in the end, they are allowed then to eat the device. So it's both great fun and it's a great learning experience. And I have never seen people, you know, falling asleep during this kind of an exercise. That means they are very active. We obey grandmother's first law. He or she who works will learn something. I have another example. So this is from one of the other courses. So these guys here, they are building up, you know, a silicon crystal. In the beginning, I did a lot of drawings on my overhead transparencies in different colors of the silicon crystal. I put them on just for a few seconds, and you know, they could never, you know, make a sketch themselves of the crystal. Of course they couldn't. Then I thought, why not make them be the active ones? So now I don't need any sketch of the crystal because they start in smaller teams, say two and two. Then they build up what we call the unit cell. This is just a small cube. Then they go together with some of the other teams, and now they merge all the unit cells, and the crystal starts to grow. It becomes larger and larger, and then we can use it throughout the course. And we also have it as part of the evaluation that they should be able to describe the different planes in the crystal. But now they have built up this crystal themselves, so now they know all about this silicon crystal. We have another exercise where we actually use a poster session where we give the students some tasks to solve. They present it at a poster session. And now it works out in a very good way. But in the beginning, it was a real disaster the very first time we tried it. Because Mads Brandby, my fellow colleague, and myself, we went to poster number one. We looked at poster number one, we discussed poster number one. And then we went to poster number two. Anyone having an idea about what happened at poster one once Mads and myself left? Anyone having a good idea? Yes? Yeah, the students, they left, of course. And you can imagine when we arrived 3.5 hours later, we arrived at poster 17. And you can guess these students, they were in a rather bad mood because they've been waiting for almost 4 hours and everybody else had left. And then some of the feedback persons, they said to Mads and myself, perhaps we should also evaluate a poster. And I have never thought about that idea. And of course, they should not evaluate one. They should not evaluate two. They should evaluate all 17 posters. So nowadays, Mads and myself are very busy going around evaluating all the posters. And all the students, they have to run around, evaluate all posters. And once they have evaluated their own poster or all other posters, then they go back to their own poster. And now they should assess their own poster and give it a grade. And then we publish both the official grade for the posters and all the other grades on CampusNet. And it's really a great exercise, and we have great fun, and there's a lot of people now being active. So we are developing this concept, but thanks to the feedback persons, it really improved. And this is just one simple example of how you can get feedback, and suddenly a concept which was a disaster turns out to be a great success, just based on a feedback discussion that took 2 minutes, and we have used it ever since. A final example of me not being active. This is Daniel. He's taking a hacksaw and he's taking a bipolar transistor apart. And when he looks in the microscope, he realizes there's a tiny chip here. And this is only a few hundred micrometer on both sides, this one. And it's a bipolar transistor. He has seen a sketch in his book, but now he has seen it in real life. And the book doesn't really cover how they package the transistors. But instead of me making slides and telling about, well, you can take a transistor, you can mount it in a metal can, and you can have something called wire bonds. Now, you know, these are just connections going to the chip. And in that way, you know, Daniel discovers this himself. And, you know, things you have discovered, you will probably never forget. Because he's very curious, what is inside? Let me have a look. And suddenly he discovers the silicon chip, and now he can figure out how many of these can you fit on a silicon disk. You will figure out that you can have thousands of these, and then he will realize that, you know, this could be a rather cheap technology, and of course it is. He will also wonder, this is the emitter, this is the base, but where's the collector? And then he will figure out, the collector was the backside of this metal can. So in that way, you know, you can discover a lot of things. So now we are discovering instead of just listening to an old man like myself making a sketch of this kind of thing. It's great fun, it's really instructive, and you can learn a lot. And once you try to use all these different techniques, it's nice to have some feedback persons to help you, to give you some feedback. So you can figure out, how can I make this even better? And that's simply the tool, or one of the tools to improve your course, but also improve your own skills as a teacher. So it gives you a secure setting, because then you can get honest feedback. If you just try, I've tried several times, you know, ask out in the class what could work better or what worked fine. Then it's always the same one or two that will say something. The rest is, you will see silence perhaps, or perhaps even the same reluctance as we had in the beginning when I asked for feedback persons. Nobody really know what to say. But here, they are only the two feedback persons and myself. We just sit down, I just listen, and I use a lot of energy in the beginning to explain to them that, of course, it will never affect the mark they get. It's just a matter of making things better and better. And then they feel secure. They give me honest feedback. Feedback I can use so I can become even better. The course can be better. And the very nice thing is that you have continuous feedback all the time throughout the semester. And the students, they can really see, you know, now he's changing something. So if I change something, I say, okay, based on feedback from the past few weeks, I think that this year I will do like this and that. Then they can see, I adjust on feedback. I try to make things better. Then they become even more eager to give me hints, or perhaps they have seen something else in another course, or if they come from abroad, perhaps they have heard about something we have never seen here at DTU. Then we can incorporate that into the course. And in that way, we become better, and the students, they also become co-responsible, because now they can come with hints and ideas, and they are active with the course, but also on developing the course, and that gives us a learning community. I learn from the students, and they can learn something from me. We can learn together, and then it's a great experience of being a teacher. Then you just becomes better and better, the students becomes better and better, and you know, we're just on a very positive spiral all the time. But of course, when you receive feedback, then there's a few things that's important, because you can imagine if the very first students in the course, they say to me, well, Eric, it works out like this and that, but it was a, you know, real disaster with in the afternoon. If I then get angry and say, no, it was not a disaster, it was a fantastic experience, you are just some dumb students. Then, of course, that will spread with the jungle drums, and you will never, you know, get feedback again. So when you, you know, receive feedback, you should receive with an open mind, also show it in your body language. You should stay neutral and not defend yourself. Do not explain, well, it was intended like this and that. Just listen and figure out, okay. Then you can ask them some questions. If they say, well, it didn't work, then you can say, okay, what should I do to make it work? Then perhaps they will say, you could perhaps try this or something else. Then you can dig into the problem and try to figure out how can we make it better. And in this way, you know, you can simply improve all the time. And of course, feedback is a gift, so even if you don't think it's a good idea, then you, of course, always say just thank you for the feedback, and then you try to figure out. Feedback doesn't mean that now the students, they just command you to change this and that. Of course, you should adjust carefully, but of course, if you hear this every year, well, the book is not that good, then perhaps when you have heard that 3 or 4 or 20 times, then perhaps you should consider finding another book. And then there will always be some noise, you know. Somebody wants the colors on the transparencies, they should be more green perhaps. Well, they could, but perhaps they shouldn't. Then the next one says, well, what about some red colors or whatever? Then you don't adjust. But if something pops up where you think, that's a brilliant idea, then try it out and see what happens. And then I have always new feedback persons. So I meet all the class, you know, in this way. So for me, it has really been extremely helpful. And before actually looking into the details of giving feedback and figuring out how can we incorporate all this, we'll have a 5-minute break. As you can see now, we are 1 minute behind schedule. It says -1. Actually, this slide was invented by one of my feedback persons. at the time where we shifted from teaching in 2x35 minutes. So we had a lesson, 35 minutes, we had a break, and another 35 minutes. That's many years ago. Then we shifted to having a 4-hour module. And now, you know, the break comes when we need it. But of course, if you stop, say, 12 minutes past 10, then you need to add, say, 15 minutes. And then that will be, say, you know, you need to figure out, because now you don't know exactly when you should be back. And people forget because it's not a fixed time. And then one of the feedback persons said, you know, perhaps we should have a countdown timer, because I had the problem that it was hard to me to find the students and we were delayed all the time. And then we invented this countdown timer. So I have it in a 5, 10, and 15 minute version. And then you can just, you know, look into the classroom and see, ah, I still have some 5 minutes left. And then you can rush for a cup of coffee. So now they are all back on time based on the feedback from the feedback persons. But now comes another exercise. Now you can perhaps see this is the same color as the last question. That was one of the feedback persons that said, if you color the questions with the same, you know, color, then we know when to discuss. That will perhaps make it even more simple. So now, you know, just like you can train a dog like Paolo did, now you can train your students. Whenever they see this color, they start to discuss. You don't have to say, now we will discuss blah, blah, blah. They just see the color, they start to discuss. And now we will use the same teams this time. And you should figure out, how will you get feedback from the students that you work with? It could be in a course, if you're going to teach in a course, or during supervision. Try to figure that out. What can you do when you come back home at the department to implement a feedback scheme? It doesn't have to be feedback persons, it could be something else, but try and figure out. And I'll give you some, say, 5 or 10 minutes in order to figure that out. And try to come up with good ideas that you believe this could work for me. Okay? And me means yourself, of course. Yeah. So please go ahead. Okay, I think it's time where we sum up, and we will do it in that way in order not to use too much time. I think we'll start here with team number one. Then you can enlighten us in your discussions, and then we can go on to team number two. And if you have something new to add or something else to add, then you add it. And otherwise, just mention, well, we had kind of the same discussions. But of course, it could be nice to hear all around the table. I think we will try with team number one here. So how will you get feedback when you come back to your departments?
Well, we discussed that it probably depends on which kind of lecture you give.
Yes.
And for instance, in the case of a single master student following for the thesis,
yeah,
it would be a very close relation, so it's easier to discuss it directly with him. Maybe before you go through together.
Yes. Yeah. So you are mostly going to do supervision?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Definitely, you are on one-to-one. It helps lowering the barriers. What you could consider was actually after the exam, you could meet, and then you could ask for some feedback as well. Then you are sure that now the mark is given. Then perhaps the feedback would be even more honest. Normally, I do that with my master students. So we meet and we evaluate, you know, everything. How did the project go? How was the supervision? You can also consider when you start, actually, even before you start the master project, to discuss with the student, what is good supervision? Because it can differ a lot from student to student, you know. Some need help with deadlines, some need help with math, somebody else need help with something completely different, you know. Coming at 9 o'clock may be a challenge. Perhaps it's time to change that habit of arriving at 12 o'clock. So perhaps they need some assistance to be able to arrive 8:30. and so on. So it can be discussed in the beginning, and then you have an idea about what kind of help does that student need. Okay, let's hear the next team.
We talked about first of all, the feedback from two pointed out persons is definitely a good idea. But if you want to have an alternative to that, it could be if you're giving lectures, putting up a box, asking everybody when they leave the classroom to have put a little note in the box that's still anonymous, saying pointing out one good and one bad thing about the teaching period.
Sure.
So that would be, then you'll get feedback from everybody, maybe on a daily basis or a weekly basis or whatever you choose. So that could be an alternative or something on the top of the feedback.
You could also ask people to leave a note on a board, and you know, there's a lot of things that could be done. I noticed you used the way one good thing and one bad thing. I suggest that when you discuss feedback with the students, you try and avoid the word bad, because if you use what was good and what can be better, then you have, you know, kind of a more positive atmosphere where you are looking for improvements instead of what was wrong, then what can be better. Then you look not backwards, but you look towards the future. And I think most students, they would like to say, well, it could be better with this and that, but perhaps they don't dare to say something bad to you, but they would like to come with suggestions and so on. And let's hear next team. That must be team three. Yes.
But we also discussed in the way of making anonymous contributions that you could ask your students to discuss something and then present somebody else's view.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. What is the advantage of doing it in an anonymous way?
It might be difficult for somebody to come forth and say everything is wrong.
Yes. You know, sometimes the students I deal with, they also say, could we have something that could be anonymous when we discuss things? And I say, no. And the reason for me is that we are trying to educate responsible engineers of the future. And if we train them to be anonymous, that doesn't really, for me, mean to be responsible. Because when they go out in a company, perhaps they go out as civil engineers, and then, you know, one of the senior engineers, his, you know, or she is doing a bridge and are doing some calculations. They might be wrong. Perhaps you've had a course here at DTU with a method which is much better to calculate, say, the stiffness of some elements in the bridge. If you are not used to giving feedback, then perhaps you don't dare to say to the senior engineer, the senior specialist, well, I know a much better way. Could we do like this and that? Because now you're trained not to speak up. So I explain to the students, because sometimes they say to me, but why do we have to be feedback, some of us? I say it's also a training in speaking up. Because if they are trained in speaking up, then they will just say, well, perhaps we could do like this and that. And then this bridge will be better. Perhaps it will not fall apart or whatever. So in that way, I think being responsible also means to speak up. But of course, it needs some training, especially for those who are not used to it. What about the next team?
But also, we talked about if you're a teaching assistant or something like that, you don't necessarily have the students all the time and don't have them. So it will be a bit overkill to pick two students at a time.
Sure.
But maybe you could introduce in the beginning course with a smile or something, that you don't want to see any negative feedback on the campus at the end. If they have them, well, that you haven't heard, it's of course personal, finally give them, but they should come with them during the course so they can experience the change instead.
Sure. I mean, it's always good to have these kind of discussions, what can be better in all courses, also when you are a teaching assistant. Perhaps it could be arranged in another way, perhaps the problem should be changed a little bit. Yes. Next team.
We were very much on the pace of having individuals sitting being responsible for giving feedback, and the volunteers afterwards in relation to having an entire course instead of having volunteers simply make, or you, when you have the list of participants, so you simply assign people every single time, so everyone has the chance to go through it.
Yes.
And there is, like, you don't, asking for volunteer, nothing will happen. If you just force volunteers, it goes a little bit faster.
Well, but then they're not volunteers.
Well, they need to realize that it's good, so yeah.
Okay.
You also get a more representative view. If you have more students, than what you can actually go through in the duration of the course, then it's easier that you get a more broad view of what you're teaching.
I mean, they can be assigned in many different ways.
Yeah.
I actually prefer to have it as volunteers, because then they had to show responsibility. I'm not forcing them, they have to show up. And in the end, you know, when I think, well, I guess there are some 10 or 15 that have never been feedback persons, I start by asking, so today we need some feedback persons, two of them, who has been a feedback person? Because if you ask a question that people would like to answer, then of course they will raise their hand. All those that have been the good guys or good girls, they raise their hands, and now we are looking at all those sitting there, and then you know, two of them will sign up. And then next time you can repeat the exercise, and in the end they will all sign up. But it's actually, you know, you have not forced them.
Yeah, sure.
They have realized that it's needed, because I never start without having feedback persons. And it helps, you know, and if you think that the reluctance is too big, you can just say, well, perhaps we should have self-study today. Then of course they see, Eric actually means that we should definitely sign up to be feedback persons. And you know, in that way, it always turns out within a minute or so, you have the feedback persons. And in the end, they just sign up, you know, even before I ask. Yes, but sure, it can be done in many different ways. We take the next team.
Yeah, we were talking about oral evaluation feedback can be better,
yes,
because we don't misunderstand the reason. But I think the other thing very
Yes. Sure, I mean,
it is difficult.
It's difficult if you have something written and you don't understand what did that student mean when he or she wrote in CampusNet something that you sometimes I see comments that I think, well, what does that mean? And you don't really know. That's the nice thing about having the students there. Then you can ask them some questions and try to figure out what was meant with this statement. Sure. The next team?
Yeah, we also discussed the note thing, but
yes,
we discussed also that large classes, this might be a bit too big a setup.
Mm.
Then maybe you could use some kind of digital aids.
Hmm.
Loading system.
Yeah, that's also possible. And the next team?
Yeah, well, we basically discussed about the questionnaire.
Yes.
So possibility for students to leave their own opinion after each class.
Yeah. Sure. And when we had a tiny discussion also, what we discussed was that, you know, if you have students from many different countries, there would be a large cultural difference. And you know, in some countries, a student perhaps doesn't really dare to say anything to a teacher, because he or she is ranked like kind of a god or something. And that barrier needs to be, you know, changed. So if you have many students from abroad, it's very important that you perhaps even take the discussion and try to explain, in this classroom, I would like to have a learning community. So I would like to learn from you, and you can learn from me, and we can learn together. Because otherwise, it can be extremely difficult. I've had students calling me most respected sir professor. And you can imagine, if this is the approach you have to the teacher, then it can be very difficult to say something that will make the course even better. So you have to nurture these students and try to help them to actually.
Language
can also be a barrier. So there can be many cultural barriers that you need to take actually into account. Yes. And next team?
Don't really have anything.
Okay, that's fine. So now we have been discussing how to actually get feedback from our students. Of course, we also give feedback to students, and we give them feedback at the exam, for instance, or feedback on reports or group work and the like. And I think it's important when you give feedback to students that you give the feedback in a constructive, in a caring, and a concrete way. And in order to memorize this, I call this the 3C rule, and in Danish it's the 3K rule: konstruktivt, kærligt, and konkret. So you should give feedback on behavior and not on identity, because you cannot really change your identity as a person, but you can easily change your feedback. You can empty the dishwasher more often, for instance. It doesn't mean you are, say, bad person. It just means that you have a habit of avoiding the dishwasher in the lunchroom, especially, for instance, at nanotech. It's a big problem, you know. It always looks like a place where your wife doesn't want to be. So, giving feedback on behavior and not on identity. I have an example here. You are the worst teacher on campus. Of course, you can ask yourself, well, it might be right, but it's not really constructive. It's not really caring about that poor teacher. And it's not really concrete. What does it actually mean to, you know, be the worst teacher? It could mean anything. So we could rephrase this sentence and say to the teacher instead, so now I can say to my teacher, well, I, and now I take the standpoint is that I cannot something. It's not something with the teacher, but I have a problem by concentrating when this teacher brings so many slides and speak for such a long time. So I have the problem. The teacher can help me. It's very concrete. It also shows the solution. The teacher could bring fewer slides, speak for a shorter time, perhaps even attend a course like this one. So in this way, you can make it in a constructive and a caring and a more concrete way, simply by changing. The message behind all this is kind of the same. But now we can see, he was the worst teacher because he was bringing too many slides, just like my old chemistry professors. So in that way, you can see it's kind of easy, just by playing a little bit with the language. So when you give feedback to students, it's also important, you know, you can also say, this is a very bad report, and then you can just hand that report out. It's not really caring, it's not really concrete. Of course, it's time efficient, but time is not an issue here because we burn for our subject. We would like them to make the best reports ever. So we can sit down and explain to them, well, this can be better, that figure can be improved, you can have like this and that, and so on. So in that way, we can give them feedback, then they can adjust and become even better. I have another example of giving feedback here to a group of students. You could say that they are active and engaged. So you can see you start out with something which is, in a general way, positive. Then you can be more specific. You can say, well, for instance, when this and that happened, or you asked a question, that gave a good atmosphere or whatever. Now you're more specifically positive. And now you can come with an improvement. It can be even better if you ask more questions or something like that. So in this way, we start in a general way. We become more specific, and we figure out it will be even better. So in this way, we can simply improve all the time. That could also be for a report that say it's actually pretty good. And instead of saying it's pretty good, then we can outline where this report is written in a very clear way. It has well-prepared figures. For instance, figure 8 is a very good example where it's easy to read, there's a clear message, there's a good figure caption, and so on. Your report will be even better if you do like this and that. So in that way, you can guide the students. And they will leave your office being extremely in a very good mood. Well, we was quite kind of good. We are good at making figures, for instance. And now we can make even better reports. Then you create this positive spiral. Of course, once in a while, you need to give critical feedback to students. Perhaps you have received a report which is not to the standard of this university, We don't want to see this kind of bad report here. DTU, then of course, there's nothing which is good in a specific way. Then of course, we just need to tell the students. So the message should be short. It's direct. It's not open for discussions. They cannot say, well, figure 8 is fantastic, because it's not. You decide that. You have to figure that out. And you give them instructions on how to improve. I have an example from a classroom where I had to say, I cannot teach when you are kissing all the time. You must go somewhere else and continue. So you can see it's kind of caring. They are allowed to kiss, but not in the classroom. I give instructions. They have to go somewhere else. And the statement is not kissing is not allowed, but I cannot teach, so I have a problem. That happened some years ago. I had a lot of students. They actually came from Poland, by the way. They have obtained a grant. And two of them, one boy and one girl, were extremely fond of each other. They were kissing each other all the time during the lesson. They were touching all over the body. And you can imagine the whole class was not working on electron transport or crystals or silicon technology. They were just looking at that couple in the center of the classroom. And I had really a hard time concentrating on actually working with these students, because that was happening, such a lot of things was going on in the classroom. So I had to stop and give them some instructions. It was in May, the weather was fantastic. So I took a piece of paper and then I made a tiny sketch. Have you ever been to Ermelund? Some of you have been to Ermelund. It's a nice place. There are some lakes over there and trees. And you know, it's a lovely place to go in May. So they could go there and continue whatever they were doing. And I thought, well, I wonder, will I ever see these students again? And the next time, at 8 o'clock, they arrived. They were standing outside the classroom, kissing and touching, of course, as usual. Then they went into the classroom, and they were sitting hand in hand. They were looking at each other in a very cute way, but they were not kissing. They were not touching all over their body. I don't think they attended really the lesson, but they were behaving. And then in the break, they rushed out of the classroom and start to kiss again. And then after the break, it continued. And you know, in that way, it really helped them. So in that way, we can give instructions. Because there's a nice thing about being the teacher. I mean, you have some power in the classroom. You can ask people to kiss somewhere else, of course. And you can see this one doesn't really go the other way around. They cannot say to me, Eric, you have to go somewhere else and speak about the silicon crystal, because we want to kiss and make love in the classroom. That doesn't really happen.
I have a question to that.
Yes?
I was just thinking about that before, like authority.
Yes.
In when teaching, don't you think that's a problem for a lot of new teachers, especially if you're teaching people about the same age as yourself? And
sure,
how
sure.
How do you kind of say establish that?
It's a good point. I think just by being the teacher will actually help. And you have prepared something. And these students, they want to work with the course, and they want to learn a lot. And I'm pretty sure that they will, you know, try and follow your instructions. So I don't think that you need authority, perhaps to throw out people of the classroom. But it happens once in a lifetime, I guess. So perhaps it won't happen the first years for you. But of course, it is an issue. But it's also a great possibility, because you are much younger. You can have a much better understanding, like a very old teacher who thinks that people are like they were back in the 1950s or something like that. He or she might have even larger problems. Mm. But clearly, it's a challenge for some. But I think it's also a fantastic opportunity. Did that help?
Yep.
Yes. Okay. Other comments like this one? But clearly, it's important also to take into account, and knowing that you have kind of a power, that also gives you a responsibility to actually handle that situation in a good and positive way. And in the end, you will grade the students as well. And of course, that should also be done in a good way. So there's a lot of things to actually take into account. But even when you give the critical feedback, it's important to remember the 3C or the 3K rule. And of course, this 3C and 3K rule is not only for the classroom. It also works with kids or with your wife or husband. It's nice to have in, you know, get feedback in a caring and concrete way. And speaking about language and how we phrase things, there are a few words where you should be careful. For instance, the word but, or in Danish, men. It has kind of like an effect like a delete button on your computer. Because you can start out, well, this was exciting, this was good, but. And when most people hear the word but, then they erase all the good stuff. Now they can hear all the bad teachers in primary school being angry, or angry parents, or whatever. And then people very often forget all the good stuff, and now they are looking for the disaster. And you can very easily change this by using the and instead. And it will become even better and blah, blah, blah. Then, you know, and means something good or something else. But means often something, that was not that good. Also, when you, you know, when you correct a report, I often use different colors because most students, they are used to that everything in red means it's bad. But perhaps you just have a suggestion. You could consider doing like this and that. If you use the red pen, most students will actually think, well, we have done something wrong. If it's a green pen, and you only use red whenever there's something which is actually, you know, wrong, an equation that was derived in a wrong way or a misspelling or a conclusion that needs to be adjusted, then you can use a red pen, and otherwise you can use another kind of color that can actually put a signal to the students that this is just a suggestion. So you can do a lot of things both with language but also in the written case. And in this way, we now know that we should be careful when we give feedback. We also know we should definitely think about how we phrase the feedback, how we use the words, and how we can actually get inspired by all this to plan our feedback. So in the beginning of a course, it can be a very good idea to present the feedback concept just to avoid the reluctance that we saw this afternoon. Also, the students know, okay, feedback is actually taken very seriously in this course. You can use feedback persons, but as some of you said, you could have a quiz or a test or some kind of a questionnaire. You could perhaps also consider asking some of the colleagues from this course to come and attend your first lectures to get some good ideas. Then you have somebody outside the classroom, but they can sit there, just listen, and then you can get some hints and feedback. Sometimes you can also use a midterm evaluation in the middle of the course. And of course, in the end, you have the final evaluation, perhaps your own, but also you have the one on CampusNet. There, I think it's a good idea also to present the final evaluation. So you can present it to the students and say, well, it looks like this. Next year, I will do like this and that, or next year, I will not change anything, or next year, perhaps a new book or whatever. Then they can see, it really helps. Then they can see you act on the feedback. That means perhaps they will be more willing to use the 5 minutes it takes in the next course to also give feedback. And at the exam, of course, you also figure out something about if they can solve the kind of problems or describe the topics. I once also did a post-festum evaluation. I made an agreement with the students that in 1 year from now, I will send them a questionnaire that they should try to answer. And a lot of them actually did. And then as part of the UDTU didactical courses, I used that in one of my reports to study the mark at the exam and then the mark a year after. So luckily there was a correlation, but some of those who didn't really do that well at the exam, they had a very good understanding a year after. So it was quite exciting to see. And then of course, in the end, it's a matter of reflection. You reflect, you try to figure out what should I preserve and what should I change? And in this way, you can make everything better and better and better. And you will be a better teacher. We have better courses at DTU. We get better students. And then, you know, students from DTU and the DTU image just becomes better and better because we all use the feedback. And in that way, we can create the best university in the world. And this is just the basic idea behind all this, being better all the time. And having said that, I'll just say thank you for your attention and a thanks to a lot of my colleagues that have helped develop many of these concepts. So I guess that's it for the afternoon. And of course, I would like to see the feedback persons. Yeah.